It'll be 4 years in May that my mother-in-law passed away. She had colon cancer. And so my father-in-law, who's now 91, has been alone. And it's been a real adjustment for him in the first year or two, especially. He's had to learn how to prepare meals, which he never had to do. For 65 years, my mother-in-law doted on him and made all of his meals and provided in so many ways in their marriage. And it's been a lonely time for him, and he's talked about how the meal time has been the hardest time of the day. And some of you know what that's about, when you have to eat alone. It's not good. In fact, sometimes we feel awkward if we are at a restaurant and we're by ourselves, or we hesitate maybe to go to a movie alone, because people might look at us and say, oh, guess they don't have any friends, because we're by ourselves. Loneliness is very real, and it's very hard. And I want to talk about it this morning in the context of experiencing a loss. This sermon series, this is the second installment out of four, where I'm talking about dealing with loss. Last week I talked about sorrow. Today I want to talk about loneliness. And in the coming weeks, I'm going to talk about guilt and then anger when it comes to losing a loved one. And, you know, when it comes to loneliness, it's important to understand the difference between loneliness and solitude. Because sometimes we want to be alone, right? Sometimes we need to be alone. Loneliness is unwanted isolation. Loneliness is when you don't want to be alone, basically. And solitude is when you're seeking time apart or seeking isolation. And that's something Jesus sought. When you read the Gospels, you find there were times when Jesus pulled away from the crowds and just needed some alone time to pray and talk to his Heavenly Father. I mean, think about the crowds that he dealt with. You know, he just needed to kind of step away, and we call that solitude. But what I'm talking about this morning is loneliness that comes out of a sense of loss. And there's things that people can do when they're lonely. There's practical things that you can do when you lose somebody and you feel that loss. And the loneliness most often comes when you lose someone that you spend a lot of time with, and that's why you miss them so much. Someone that lived in your home, whether it was a child or a spouse or whomever, the more time you spent with them, it's likely that that greater sense of loneliness will come. Some people go to the cemetery and feel like they can still visit the person that passed, and they might talk to them. I was curious to see that when the Eagles won the Super Bowl a few weeks ago, there was examples of men, grown men, who had grown up rooting for the Eagles with their fathers. And their father had since passed years ago, and now the Eagles won the Super Bowl. And so there were cemeteries where there were headstones with an Eagle jersey over it, as if to say, Dad, we finally did it. And this was a way of connecting with that person that had passed and sharing that moment and that joy with them. Sometimes people will write letters to the deceased as a way of keeping a connection and easing the loneliness, saying to them in the letter what it is they would say to them if they were sitting there in a chair. Some people keep a journal and write about their loneliness and their grief as a way of working through those emotions. And sometimes when the loneliness persists over a long period of time and is deep and profound, it may be time to go to a counselor and get some help walking through that part of the journey of grief. But this morning, I want to go a little deeper and a little further and talk about how God can be with us in the midst of our loneliness and what that experience of loneliness can be like when God speaks to us in the midst of our loneliness and helps us work through that feeling of loneliness. So I want to look at a particular account in the scripture. It's from the Old Testament in 1 Kings chapter 19. It's a story involving Elijah the prophet. 1 Kings chapter 19. But before I start talking about what happened in this chapter, I want to take you back one chapter before. Chapter 18 is a great chapter in the Old Testament. It was a showdown between two gods. You see, people in the Old Testament often worshipped a god called Baal, B-A-A-L. AAL. It was more or less a god of agriculture. People who were involved in pagan worship would worship Baal, thinking that their crops would do better if they worshiped this god. And at the same time, you had people like Elijah, who were a prophet of the true God, the God of Israel. And so this showdown came down to the point where the two gods were going to compete in a showdown. There was an altar set up, and the agreement between the two sides, almost like an Olympic event, a competition, the one side said to the other, and both agreed, that the God that can bring fire down on the altar is the real God. So the prophets of Baal went first, and they're praying for their god Baal. Oh, Baal, bring down fire. And they're dancing around and cutting themselves and doing all kinds of things to invoke Baal to respond, and nothing happened. And then it was Elijah's turn, and he has them pour water on the altar, and more water, as if to say, watch this. And then he prays to God. God sends down, boom, all this fire. God wins. And so Elijah, feeling the moment, says, so all the prophets of Baal now are to be killed. And they killed all the prophets of Baal. Well, the queen, who was a wicked woman, Jezebel, got wind of this. And she was not a worshiper of Elijah's God. She says, I'm now going to kill all the prophets of God, which she did. And somehow, Elijah escaped, and he's on the run, and she's determined to find him and kill him. And so, in the next chapter, chapter 19, you have this guy, Elijah, who just came through this amazing experience with God, but he's alone now, because they killed all of his buddies, all of his colleagues or comrades, all the other prophets of God, they were all killed. And so he's alone and afraid for his life. And in chapter 19, verse 4, it says, while Elijah himself went a day's journey into the wilderness, he came to a broom bush, sat down under it, and prayed that he might die. I've had enough, Lord, he said. Take my life. I'm no better than my ancestors. Then he laid down under the bush and fell asleep. Wow. He's had enough. Have you ever said, that's it, I can't take anymore? That's it, God, I'm done. That's where he was at, all alone, filled with despair, lays down, I don't care whether I live or die. And then, God answers. In the next verses, it says that an angel touched him and said, get up and eat. And he looked around, and there was baked bread, and there was a jar of water. So the first response of God is to meet Elijah's physical needs. And sometimes when we lose a loved one that was so dear to us and we're so broken and feeling that loneliness and despair, we forget to eat. We forget to take care of our immediate needs. And loved ones have to say, now don't forget to eat. Or we bring food to people after a funeral as a way of saying, come on now, take care of yourself. So that's the first response we see by God, sending this angel to take care of his basic needs. And then God asks Elijah a question, and it's a good question. In verse 9, the word of the Lord came to Elijah. What are you doing here, Elijah? What are you doing here? It's a question that really means, what's going on? What are you going through here? How are you feeling? What's happening? He's asking Elijah to open up and share his heart because God wants to hear about the loneliness and the despair. God's willing to hear what it is you have to say to him about what you're going through, feeling like you just want to lay under a tree and give up. And so Elijah responds in verse 10. He says, I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty, meaning I'm doing my thing. I'm doing what you call me to do, God. I'm doing my best. The Israelites have rejected your covenant. They've torn down your altars and put your prophets to death with the sword. And then he says it. I am the only one left. And now they're trying to kill me too. I'm the only one left. it's amazing. You can go to a party where there's 30 people and you can feel all alone. If you're not connected to those people, or if the one you yearn for is not with you, you can be lonely even in the midst of a large crowd. And Elijah's feeling lonely and filled with despair. I'm the only one left, and soon I'll be gone too. And then God responds in this conversation. Verse 11, the Lord said, "Go out and stand on the mountain in the presence of the Lord, for the Lord is about to pass by." He says, "I'm going to show up." Now, the Old Testament belief was that no one could see God and live. Their understanding was that God was so awesome and so great and powerful and full of bright light and all that a human being couldn't actually see God and live. It would just be so overwhelming, it would just like knock us out. So he says, "Get ready, I'm going to pass by." Then a great and powerful wind tore the mountains apart and shattered the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. After the wind, there was an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. After the earthquake came a fire, but the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire came a gentle whisper. When Elijah heard it, he pulled his cloak over his face and went out and stood at the mouth of the cave. He knows that he shouldn't see God, so he covers his face. What's going on here? God shows up. There's an earthquake. There's wind. There's fire. But the author says, but God wasn't in that. As if to say, Elijah, you need a dramatic demonstration? You need something like what we did in the last chapter when I sent down the fire? Is that what you need? It's not like that every day, is it? Lord, I'm down here and I'm doing my best and I'm all alone. Can't you show up so I know that you're with me? Is that what Elijah was looking for? Some dramatic appearance of God? God says, yeah, I'm still here. I can do all these mighty things. I can split the mountains. I can bring great wind. I can bring fire down. But I'm not in that. Rather, I'm in the gentle whisper that came after all that. And so after the gentle whisper, God says again, repeats the question, what are you doing here, Elijah? Almost as if to say, let's come back to the question. We talked about this a minute ago, but now that you've seen this demonstration and you've heard my gentle whisper, now I ask you again, what's going on for you? And Elijah repeats the same thing. I've been very zealous for the Lord God Almighty. The Israelites have rejected your covenant, torn down your altars, and I'm the only one left. And then the Lord said to him in verse 15, go back the way you came and go to the desert of Damascus. And when you get there, anoint Hazael king over Aram. And then he goes on to describe two other anointings that he wants him to do. He wants him to anoint two kings and anoint Elisha. It's confusing. There's Elijah and Elisha. Elisha was the prophet to follow Elijah. He says, anoint him as my next primary prophet. So God listens to what Elijah says. He hears his despair. He doesn't shut him down. He says, pour it on. Share your heart. Tell me how you really feel. And after you've had a time to do that, know that there's another season in your life. I have more for you to do, and your life is not over. It may feel like it is, and you may feel like you're the only one, but I am here, and I have another assignment for you. So in the midst of his loneliness, God says, here's how I want to help you to cope. I want you to get going again. And sometimes that's the only way we come through desperate loneliness, is to realize we've got to somehow continue on because life goes on. Maybe it means volunteering in a hospital. Maybe it means getting involved in a ministry at the church. But plugging in and again, allowing ourselves to be around people. And God gives Elijah a little reality orientation at the end of the passage. He says to him in verse 18, yet I reserve 7,000 in Israel, all whose knees have not bowed down to Baal and whose mouths have not kissed him. You think that you're alone and you feel lonely, but you are not alone. There are 7,000 who have not bowed to Baal. They're still on your side. They're on our side. You're not alone. Yes, you feel lonely, but you are surrounded by support. And I want you to continue. And here is your assignment. God meets Elijah in his season of loneliness and despair and points him beyond his loneliness and despair and says, I still have a plan for you. And what's interesting is that God was not in those dramatic events. He was in the whisper. And what did Elijah hear in the whisper that enabled him to continue? Because he picks himself up and he continues to serve God. God wanted him to hear something that evidently he couldn't hear normally. And that's how it is in life, I find. Day-to-day life, there's bills to pay, go to work, go to school, meals to eat, things to plan. And God may be whispering, but you can't hear it when you're that involved and busy. And sometimes it's only in a certain circumstance that you can begin to listen and hear the gentle whisper. Max Lucado, Christian author, explains it this way. Suppose you're going to take a trip in the car and your car is not working well, so you ask to borrow your friend's car and they say, sure. Now, this trip is going to take hours. So you get in the car and you start driving down the road and you go about an hour and you stop for a rest stop and when you get back in the car, you realize that, you know, this is a long drive and it's going to go a lot faster with some music. And you're a huge country music fan. You may have to use your imagination. You're a huge country music fan, and so you start going through the CDs that he has in the car. And it's all classical music. Brahms, Beethoven, Mozart. And you go, ugh, I can't listen to this stuff. So you get back in the car and you start driving. But after another hour, it's pretty quiet and it's pretty long, and you say, oh, what the heck. Grab Mozart CD, stick it in. Ugh, classical music. Drive another hour. Yeah, it's pretty neat how those wind instruments come in at the right time. It's the sound of those horns and the way they blend in. It's, hey, this is pretty cool. Next thing you know, you're humming along. Hearing music that you would never otherwise hear because you would never choose to hear that song. But sometimes life puts you and me in a place where we are forced to hear different music and a different message, one that we would not choose. And so Elijah's story tells us that sometimes, not that God wants you to be lonely, but that he can speak in the midst of your loneliness and speak a message in a quiet whisper that you would not otherwise hear and that you would not choose to hear. But still, God speaks, and it's a message of hope. And it's a message I think is contained in one of my favorite passages, which is from Isaiah chapter 43. Listen for this word of hope, Isaiah 43. But now this is what the Lord says. He who created you, Jacob, he who formed you, Israel, do not fear. I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. And when you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. That just may be the whisper that God wants to offer you in the midst of your despair and your loneliness, that there is hope and there is more. And as for my father-in-law, well, about 2 years after my mother-in-law passed, he was out taking his daily stroll. As he walked down this tree-lined street, there was a woman walking out to her mailbox. Now, my father-in-law at this point was 89, and this young lady was 80. And they met at the mailbox as he walked down the street. Oh, good morning. They start chatting. They start connecting. And my father-in-law tells the story now that as they talked, he's thinking in the back of his mind, how do I ask her out for a date? So he says, at some point in the conversation, hey, he said, you want to sometime go out for a cup of coffee? She said, let's go to a movie. It's been 2 years now. They've gone to a lot of movies. They get the senior discount, you know, during the week, during the day. And they've shared a lot of meals together so that he no longer has to eat alone. And that companionship has made all the difference for him. Oh, I'm sure he still has moments of loneliness and misses his wife of 65 years, but God has spoken to him in a gentle whisper that God has more for him, even at age 89. And now he's 91 and there's still an item. And I give thanks for the way God speaks to us, even in the midst of our despair and our loneliness. He says, I am your Savior, and you are mine. God, I just lift up anyone here this morning.